All right, so I'm assuming everyone else is at the TensorFlow talk on campus. That's all right, we're here to talk about databases. Nobody needs TensorFlow, right? I'm kidding. All right, so today is sort of the first discussion or first lecture we'll have on vectorized execution. On Tuesday next week, I'll spend sort of some of the time to talk about another vectorized execution model or execution scheme that's in Apache Quickstep. But then I'll spend the other half of the lecture talking about the sort of the trade-offs of query compilation and vectorization together, and how that sort of tied all in with how it relates to compressed data. And I'll talk a little about some of the research that we're doing to solve some of the problems we'll see in today's class. All right, so for today, we'll start to talk about sort of the background of vectorization. What does it mean to have vectorized operators or execution models inside of a database system? And then as we go along, we'll also talk about what the hardware looks like. That's going to be relevant to the evaluation we're going to do at the end, or in the paper that you guys read. And then I'll talk about a subset of the algorithms that were in the paper from the guys in Columbia that you guys read. And so I realized in this paper, they basically had a ton of different algorithms. They all sort of tried to vectorize. And in the appendix, there was like code. Hopefully you guys didn't read the code. But as I'll see, as I'll say later on, I think of this paper as a really good instructional guide that if you ever need to go back and implement vectorized algorithms, you could use this as a reference. All right. So before we begin the discussion of what vectorized execution looks like in a database system, I want to make some sort of obvious observations to motivate why we're going to talk about today. So these are just again these obvious things that everyone should know. Right, the first one, as everyone can figure out by now because you're working on Project 3, building a database system is hard. Right, it's hard to build and make it fast, and also hard to build and make it correct. Another obvious observation is that if you go to Taco Bell, you're probably going to have stomach problems. So try to avoid Taco Bell. I haven't been there in a while. The last time I went there, it was a rough ride. And the last obvious observation is that the new CPUs that Intel and other companies are putting out, they're simply not getting faster, right? You can say it's sort of it's the demise of Moore's law, but you know it's not like in the 90s and the 2000s where they would ratchet up the clock speed to get better performance. We're sort of hitting a limit of how fast you can make silicon or how much power you can rush through silicon without it melting. So we're not going to get in 10 years' time, we're not going to have magically higher clock speeds and things are just gonna be faster. So we have to look at other ways to improve the performance of our database system. And so there's essentially two types of CPU architectures that are available for us today. So the first is what we'll call multi-core CPUs. And these are the ones you're probably most familiar with, right? These are like the Xeons you get when you buy a laptop or you get a server machine, right? And these CPUs are going to be comprised of a small number of high-powered cores. And by high power, I mean that they're running at a higher clock speed, or high clock speed, and they have a sort of complex instruction set that's going to allow you to do a bunch of different things all in that core. The other two key characteristics that are going to matter for us is that they're going to be massively superscalar and support aggressive out-of-order execution. And so what that means is that we're going to have this long instruction pipeline, and the CPU is going to be executing them in sort of sequential order. But what it's going to do is that in between different clock cycles, it's going to try to execute multiple instructions by sort of preemptively going to the pipeline and picking out things that it thinks it can execute. And then it has this sort of extra mechanisms to check dependencies to see whether that turned out to be the right order. Right? So you're sort of allowed to execute things not in the order that the program actually wants you to execute them. You can sort of execute them in any arbitrary order. You just have to do extra checks to make sure that everything still come out to be correct. So what this is going to allow them to do in these multi-core CPUs, the heavyweight ones, you're going to be able to process multiple instructions per clock cycle than you would otherwise be able to do if you were just going then one after another. So the other type of CPU architecture that's common today is what's called the many integrated cores, the mix. And these are, sort of think of these sort of like a GPU, but also sort of like the Xeon Phi is another good example. So think of this as like a CPU where you have a larger number of smaller power, weaker cores, lower power cores than you had in like the regular Intel Xeon. So in the case of the Xeon Phi, It's going to have, I think the current version is like 72 cores. And each of those cores are going to be what are called Intel P54Cs. And these are essentially the same Pentium cores that Intel developed in the 1990s. Right? But back then, you had a single socket that had one of these. Now you can have one of these Xeon Phis that'll have a couple dozen. And so the key difference about these cores and the last cores I just talked about is they're not superscalar, and they only support in-order execution. And actually, the Pentium, when it came out in the 90s, was actually the first, I think, Intel CPU that supported out-of-order execution. But when they put them on the Xeon Phis, they only support in-order execution. And so the way they're going to overcome the not having out-of-order execution is that they're going to extend the instruction set on these cores to have expanded SIMD capabilities that we're able to leverage in our algorithms beyond what the regular Xeons have. Right, so they're going to have wider registers with more instructions, allow you to do more complex things you can do in a regular Xeon. So if you've never seen what these Xeon Phis look like, this is sort of a picture of from Intel's marketing. It essentially looks like a GPU, right? It goes on the PCI Express bus, you plop it down. It doesn't have a graphics output. It's just meant to do computation. The newer versions of the Xeon Phis, you can actually get them to sit on the socket. And so you can buy a machine that just doesn't have any regular Xeons, it only has Xeon Phis. And I really like the name Xeon Phi is kind of weird because I say Xeon versus Xeon Phi. They're completely different architectures, but like they're using the same branding, which I think is stupid. But that's their problem. So the newer ones you can actually get, I think, came out last year. You can actually get them to sit on the socket. I don't know whether you can mix regular Xeons with Xeon Phis, but the idea here is like in the case of Xeon Phi, any data you need to crunch on, you have to push down through the PCI Express bus to send it down and then send it back up to CPU to use it. Right? The GPUs have this sort of the same problem. And then the idea of having it on the same socket, it would be cache coherent with the regular CPUs, and then you don't have to do this marshaling back and forth. So this is going to come up later on when we look at the performance of these different algorithms. But the fact that it only supports in-order execution, but it's going to have wider SIMD registers, that's going to have different trade-offs when we looked at the vectorized algorithms. All right. So the another high-level way to look at these is again how it's going to be organized with memory and caches. So this is the architecture that we saw before with the in the many core CPUs, right? You have a shared L3 cache, and then you have four different cores on a single socket. Again, we could have this in the Newborn architecture, we could have a bunch of these, and they would connect together over the interconnect bus. The MIC architecture for the Xeon Phis actually uses a ring, and every core doesn't have L3 cache, so they only have L1, L2. And anytime, again, you need to read data communicate with these other cores, you send it along this ring bus. I think it goes in one direction. This is actually different also than the paper we read earlier on the 1,000 core stuff, right? That had this like 2D mesh because that was an architecture based on Tilera. But this is how Intel designs their Xeon Phis. All right, so why is vectorization important? Why is this actually going to matter? So we've already spent a lot of time in the semester talking about how to parallelize a bunch of different algorithms running on multiple cores, right? We talked about how to do parallel hash join, parallel sort merge join, how to have concurrency control where you can have multiple transactions running at the same time on different cores. We talked about how to do logging in parallel. And so we already know the techniques to parallelize across multiple cores. But now we throw in SIMD, now we're actually going to get an even larger performance boost, right? So say I have my machine has 32 cores. If my algorithm is perfectly parallelizable, then I'm going to get a 32x speed up when I run across all the cores. But now if each of those cores has a four wide SIMD registers that I can do processing in parallel and for vectorized execution, but now the speed up I'm getting is going to be multiplicative. So now I'll have a 32x speed up, and then for each of those cores, they'll have a 4x speed up. So for my single algorithm, if I vectorize it, I can get 128x speed up, right? Even though I only have 32 cores. And again, the wider registers you have, this number can go higher. So this is why vectorization is important, right? It's not just enough to look at, how can we parallelize all the different cores? to get the extra boost we're going to want to need to, you know, to support more complex queries and larger data sets, we want to have this multiplication factor in our system, be able to leverage that. So the idea of vectorization in sort of a sort of high level definition is that we want to take our program, we want to convert it from sort of a scalar implementation where we would normally operate, you know, or process data, you know, one piece of item at a time and apply one operand or instruction at a time. And we want to combine them into a batch and apply a single instruction to process them all in parallel that then produce a single result that has the has, you know, for our batch, right? And we saw this earlier when we talked about the way you do this is through SIMD. And we showed an example before when we talked about SIMD, but now we can go a little more detail of what is actually going on here. So again, the SIMD stuff are these extra CPU instructions that are going to allow us to do these vectorized operations to process data, multiple pieces of data in parallel. So SIMD is not a, again, it's not a Intel specific term. This is sort of a general term in computer science. So all the major instruction sets for the different microarchitectures that are out there are all going to have their versions of SIMD, and they just call them different things. So in the x86, there's the MMX came out first, and then there's the SSE stuff, and then the later things is the advanced vectors instructions, or the AVX, the advanced vector extensions. In the power architecture, they call their thing AltaVec, and then I think in the newer ARMs, they have something called Neon. And they're essentially, again, all doing the same kind of things that you guys read in the paper, right? You're doing, you know, you're doing vectorized addition, multiplication, comparisons. Gather-scatter is a bit more complicated, as we'll see as we go along. But at a high level, these things are all essentially doing the same thing. And sort of in the case of the Intel stuff, the main difference is really how wide are the registers and what kind of data types they can support in these later editions of SIMD instructions. So this is the example that we saw before, and we'll see this again when we talk about, you know, this will be a recurring thing when we talk about how to actually enable SIMD. Right? We want to take the vector X and Y, add them together, and then produce our result in the vector Z. Right? And the way we would implement this is through a simple loop. Right? The naive implementation would just be iterating over a single value and taking the offsets of the two different vectors and adding them together to Z. So if you're doing single instruction, single data item, again, it's just looking at, it's literally taking this thing and executing one at a time to produce a result. And you could turn on loop unrolling in your compiler. That only speeds up the avoiding having to do the jump to begin the loop and restart things, but you're still going to have to do the single instruction per data item. So now with SIMD, the idea is that we're going to combine a batch of these values into a single register. And again, in this case here, we're doing SSE with 128-bit registers. So that means that within one register, we can store four 32-bit integers. And then we just apply them the SIMD instruction to add them together, and then it produces our single output that is then stored in another register. But now, if depending on what algorithm we're doing, we can either just keep reusing this register and apply it to some other operation, or we can extract it out and load it into the program's memory, into L1 cache, and then process it any way we want. And actually, in the later versions of SSE, one of the big advantages that you get versus other SIMD instructions is that you can actually have this thing avoid the cache and go directly to memory. So if you say, like, say I'm doing a join, and I'm scanning through, and I'm applying this SIMD operation, if I know I'm not going to go read it again, and I want to take it out of my register, I can have the CPU store it directly into memory and avoid polluting my caches. All right, and again, we do the rest for the other part of the vector. So the streaming SIMD extensions, and again, this is sort of when these came out in the late 1990s, this is sort of when these things actually became useful. Because when MMX came out, that was sort of the first version of SIMD instructions by Intel. They were not really, really wide registers. It was only 64-bit wide. And there was an easy way for you to access them using intrinsics or other compiler flags. You had to actually write your own assembly to take things out in registers and put them into memory. And they also prevented you from executing regular instructions, non-SIMD instructions in the CPU when you ran the SIMD instructions, because it would block everything. So again, the way these things work is that you have this, in the case if it's 128-bit, you can store four 30-bit scalar values, whether floats or integers, and then perform a single operation to do whatever it is you need to do, and then write it out to another register. So the types of instructions you can do with SSE, you can do data movement, so this is copying data in and out, and we'll see this later when we do loads and stores. You can do the basic arithmetic operations. You can do logical operations, and we'll need these in order to do our comparisons when we evaluate predicates in parallel. And then the things that are actually really relevant to us is to do shuffling and these other conversion things. So shuffling is going to allow us to take the contents of a SIMD register and write it to another register. And again, the idea here is we want to do as much processing as we can on the data we pack into our SIMD registers without having to go back into the CPU caches. So if we need to permute them or transform them to put them into a particular output, or to align them a certain way, we can have the CPU write from one register to the next without having to go back to the caches. And for in terms of conversion, this is essentially transforming data from how it's being represented in your CPU caches, right? There's one representation for integers maybe in the CPU or that will be different than how they are in SIMD, and this allows you to seamlessly, you know, convert them to the right format. And the cache control I talked about before is allows us to move data directly from the SIMD registers out to memory to avoid polluting our caches. And again, this is useful for things like joins. If we know we're scanning through our table and we're probing the hash table, if we find a match for our tuples, we don't want to, you know, in our SIMD registers, we don't want to put them in our CPU memory. We don't want to write them out we don't want to put them in our caches. We want to write them out to memory because we know that as we complete the scan, we're never going to go back and look at those things. It's only when the next operator starts we may want to go bring those things back into our CPU caches. So the cache control is going to allow us to do that. So this is a table that was a presentation from James Rendier, who was a Intel director, one of the lead guys working on SIMD for a long time at Intel. And this just shows you, in the case of the Intel architecture, the different editions or variations of SIMD or how it's improved, right? So MMX came out in 1997, and then the SSE stuff came out later with wider registers. And as you can see, since the very beginning, they always supported integers, but only in the later ones, so they have the single precision and double precision floating point numbers. Then at the bottom here, you see that at AVX is the latest version of this, of SIMD instructions, and that's where you have 256-bit registers. And then the AVX 512 is when you go to 512 bits. And we talked about before, in the case of sort merge, we need this in order to do parallel sort merge because we need to be able to sort 128-bit values because we have to pack in the tuple offset and the actual sort key. But in the current, this is currently not available in any regular Xeon CPU. Xeon Phi has this. Supposedly, it's supposed to come out in the next Skylake Xeon from Intel later this year. I don't know whether that's true or not. I can't get a clear answer from anything I've read online. But if this is actually true, then now we can actually start doing the parallel sort merge using SIMD, which I think would be kind of cool. So the other thing to point out is you clearly see that they're doubling the size as you go down, the size of the width of the registers. It's unlikely, I think, that they're going to go to 1024-bit registers, SIMD registers, because 512 is the current cache line size. So when you do that, then you have to change other aspects of the system, and that may cause problems. So I suspect that Intel will be able to put out the 512 AVX instruction set in Xeons pretty soon, but then whether they go to 1024 is not clear. Yes?
As the SIMD become wider, isn't also CPU cycles wasted in loading data into the SIMD registers? How many cycles will be wasted in that?
So his question is, as the registers get wider, do you waste more cycles copying data into the
registers?
Yeah, as the SIMD register, why would they get slower? Why would that be more cycles?
I mean, you would be spending some amount of cycles in loading the data into the register, right?
Yes.
So how much is that?
This question is like how much overhead is actually loading data in? So one, I think that's independent of the size of the registers. Well, it depends on how many things you actually you want to store in it. We'll actually talk about this in a second, right? It's actually you know, in the paper they talk about doing the vectorized load and store. In actuality, you can't do that truly in parallel because the CPU only allows like one or two accesses to L1 per, right? So yes. If you want to store, if you want to use, say, the 512 register with a lot of lanes, because maybe you're doing SIMD on like 16-bit integers, then yes, it'll take more time to store things in because it's the way the L1 works. In the case of like if we want to do 128-bit lanes, then you pay four cycles. Right, so I think it depends on how many lanes you want to use for these things. I don't think it depends on the size of the value. Yes?
So I think 512 bits is a cache line size.
Yes.
It's not a scatter load and store. It will actually be the same speed as the normal load and store.
Right, so his statement is, yeah, so I said this before, 512 is the cache line size. So you're saying if it's larger than this, then it's just the same as doing a regular load and store in a memory. Is that what you're saying? Sorry.
No, I'm saying that if it's from the same cache line.
Yes.
Not a scatter gather loaded, then it's the same as a normal integer.
Yes. So he said So he's saying if this is the same cache line, then if all the values you need to pack into your register are in the same cache line, right? It's just they're just contiguous, then it's just one load to go suck that cache line and put it into this. He's right, yes. But if it's a scatter gather where you're reading different parts of memory, then you're gonna pay whatever, a cycle per load, assuming it's an L1. Okay, so this sounds awesome, right? SIMD is, you know, clearly this is something that we're going to want to be using in our database system. It is, this is sort of this is one aspect of how Intel is going to get better performance out of their CPUs. In addition to adding more cores, they're going to add better SIMD instructions. So now we've got to figure out how do we actually enable this. All right, and we basically have three choices to do this. So the first is that we don't do anything in our code, right? Again, we're the database developers. We get paid a lot of money. We're working on our system, and we just don't bother changing any of our algorithms, and we just hope we enable some flags in the compiler, you know, in GCC or if the Intel compiler ICC. We just hope that the compiler is going to be smart enough to find, you know, opportunities in our code to be able to vectorize them, right? So. The problem with this is that it's only going to work for really simple loops, and you have to have your loop constructed the correct way in order for this to work. And in the context of a database system, these simple loops are going to be really rare because we're going to be doing we're doing complex things. Now, this is part of the reason why I showed you the vector-wise sort of primitives at the end of last class, because they create these really simple loops that are just doing really simple operations. And then they rely on the compiler to be able to find these loops and vectorize them for the system. But in general, in the case in our own system, if you have more complex code base, then the compiler is not going to be able to find these things. And then if you're also doing query compilation with the LLVM, the LLVM is not going to do as aggressive optimizations as the GCC or ICC will. You sort of have to program these things yourself. And obviously, having support, you know, having the compiler be able to turn on this vectorization requires you to have hardware support, right? Because otherwise, it's just going to keep everything and be always scalar. But nowadays, as I said, most CPUs will have this. All right, so let's look at an example that I had before and talk about why automatic vectorization may not work. So this is that same loop that I had where I was taking x and y and writing them to z, right? So I'm going to take a guess why or why not this cannot be automatically vectorized. Who here has taken a compiler's course? Okay, so let's start with a simple question. Can this be automatically vectorized? Yes or no? Raise your hand if you say yes. A few. Raise your hand if you say no. Nobody. Okay, the answer is no. All right. This is actually not legal because the compiler doesn't know what these things are actually pointing to, right? Because they're passed in at runtime, right? So they may actually be pointing to the same address or the same location in memory, right? You could have like the x and z point to the same memory location. So that means that when you write into z, you're also writing into x. So let's say at iteration 0, you write into z. That overwrites the value in iteration one for x. So if you vectorize that, you would actually end up with the incorrect result, right? So for the way this code is written, and this is the byproduct of just C or C++, the program is telling the compiler that this thing has to be done sequentially, right? Because there's these dependencies potentially inside these loops, where the output of one iteration may affect the input to the next iteration. So the compiler would look at this and say, well, I can't do anything, because I don't know whether you truly meant for me to allow you to overwrite Z, and that would, when you write into Z, that would overwrite something in X. It doesn't know whether that's actually what you want or not. So it always plays it safe, right? The compiler's job is to end up with correct code. So it's going to avoid this optimization. So the way we can get around this is to provide hints to the compiler. So we can basically tell it in our code, we can say, hey, look, I know what's actually going on here, and I know what data I'm going to be always passing into you, so it's okay for you to go ahead and vectorize this. It may not always do this, but in general, it usually does. And so there's two ways we can do this. There's one way we can give it information about what we know about the memory locations we're passing into that function, or we can just tell it, ignore the loop dependency that you normally would enforce, loop dependency checking, and just go ahead and vectorize it. So the first way to do this, in the first example, is that we can use the restrict keyword in C and C++. I don't actually think this is in the standard in C++, but I compiled this and it works. I think it's in like C++ 99, it's good enough. And the idea here with the restrict keyword is basically you're telling the compiler that these memory locations at X, Y, and Z, they're guaranteed to be distinct or not overlap, so it's okay to go ahead and vectorize this. Right, and in Intel's compiler, it'll definitely do this. And I think in GCC, if you pass in the vectorized flag, it'll be able to handle that one too. The other approach is to use these pragmas to tell it, the compiler, that for the loop that's right below me, ignore that dependency checking that I know about. Right, so the pragma IVDEP means ignore the vector dependencies. And then the compiler said, yes, I don't care that X, Y, and Z are the same. I'm going to go ahead and vectorize this exactly as you want. There's other directives you can use. There's like OpenMP directives. I've seen there's also like PragmaSIMD. There's a bunch of other things that I think all do the same thing. The key thing about this, though, is that it's up for you as the programmer to make sure that this actually ends up being correct, right? Because the compiler will do exactly what you want it to do. Then you have to go back and decide whether, is this speeding up your program, or are things actually getting, and is the result still correct? In the case of database systems, unlike machine learning sometimes you can be loosey-goosey about the weights and numbers and things like that, because it doesn't really affect the final outcome, right? Because there, in many cases, machine learning, there's not always going to be like a single correct answer, right? Because it's doing approximation of things. But if you're computing like salary and totals or bank account numbers, then you want these computations to be precise. So therefore, this may cause problems. So the last way to get vectorization is to put explicit commands or explicit instructions in your code to tell the CPU exactly what you want it to do. And the idea here is that you want to say, you don't even bother with these pragmas or directives or hints, and you just write your code be exactly to use the SIMD instructions that you know you want to use. And this is essentially the approach that the Columbia guys use in the paper. Like if you look in the appendix, they're using CPU intrinsics in all the different algorithms. So the only downside of this is, one, it's hard to write, right? The syntax for these intrinsics are a bit archaic, and you have to always have to look. At least for me, I have to look in the table to see what they actually mean, because they're abbreviated. And then the other downside is that they're potentially not portable. And I'll show what that means in a second. But if you say you run on like the 128-bit SSE instructions, and you want to go to AVX 512, the intrinsics that you're going to use now all have to be changed. All right, so this is again the same loop that we had before, and now what I'm doing is in the first part I'm going to store the vectors that are being passed into these 128-bit SSE registers, and then in my loop I'm now going to invoke the vectorized addition of 32-bit integers for my two vectors here, and then write it out to the output vector. Again, this is me telling the compiler exactly what instructions I want to do, because what's going to happen is the compiler will see these intrinsics and convert them into the inline assembly that performs the exact instructions that it needs. Right? And again, the example of what I said about how this may not be portable is, say, again, I'm using 128-bit registers. Say I go to AVX 256 or 512, I would have to change these numbers here. Right? I think there may be libraries that can sort of extract this away from you, but I haven't looked enough to see whether there is something there. Right? So any question about this, right? There's three approaches. You can sort of hope that the thing's going to figure it out for you. You can provide hints to the compiler to try to vectorize certain parts, or you can do explicit instructions to do exactly what you want to do. All right, so now we can talk about how do we use for our purposes, we're just always assuming we're using intrinsics, that we know exactly what our system is going to be doing. Now we're going to talk about how do we actually use these to do vectorized execution in our database system. So the way this is going to work is, in the paper, they sort of start off with some basic primitives or fundamentals of doing vectorized execution, like how to do predicate evaluation and deal with compression. And then sort of build them up to do more complex things, like sorting and merging. And then from then, we can then sort of combine all these things together to do the more complex operations we want to do in our relational algebra, to do things like multi-way tree joins or the bucketized hash tables. So these are like sort of the simple things, and we sort of build on them to do the more complex things. So again, so this is why I had you guys read this paper, because again, it sort of starts in the beginning and then builds up to do the kind of things we've been talking about all semester in our relational operators. So they're first going to provide the fundamentals of vectorized operations and then build up from them to do more complex things. And there's two sort of edicts or guiding principles that they want to have in their algorithm, their vectorized algorithms. So the first is that they're going to favor vertical vectorization over horizontal vectorization by allowing us to process different data items per lane. And again, think of a lane as like in the SIMD register, say it's a 128-bit register, and I can store four 32-bit integers in it. Each of those sort of integers would be in a lane. Right, so I can have four 32-bit lanes in a 128-bit register. So the idea here is that we want to get, by doing vertical vectorization, we're always going to be processing new data in all our lanes rather than computing things that we already know the answer to. And this is allowed and also to have full lane utilization by executing different data items in our input sequence at our different lanes instead of going in directly in sequential order that the data was passed into our operator. And again, I'll cover this more when we talk about doing the hash tabling probing, and this will become more obvious. All right, so first I want to start off with the basic fundamental operations you can have that can be vectorized. So select a load and store, there should be a T there, and then gather and scatter. And then we'll build up from there and show how to do vectorized scans, and vectorized histograms and vectorized joins. All right, so for selective load, the basic idea here is that we want to take some contents of memory and just write out to particular lanes in our input register. So the way we're going to be doing this is that we're going from sort of top to bottom. So this is our target, right? We want to write data into this SIMD register, this vector. And the data is going to come from some location in memory. So what we're going to have is that we're going to have a mask where we have zeros and ones that correspond to each lane in our SIMD register. And if it's a zero, means that we don't want to write anything into it. If it's a one, then we do want to write something into this. And what's going to happen is we're going to go in sequential order along our in memory and start writing them out to the register. So in the first step here, at the first lane, the value is zero, so we don't write anything to the first lane up here. But then for this one, the value is 1, so we do want to overwrite something here. So we'll go to the first memory location at our starting address, and we'll just write it up in there. Right? And the next one's 0, so obviously we skip that. The last one's 1, so yes, then at the second position, we write its contents in there. Right? Now, selective store does the reverse. So the idea here is that, again, the top part is our target. So we're going to take some contents in our SIMD register, in our vector, and we want to write it out to memory. And again, we'll have another mask that's going to tell us for what lane should we be writing out data to memory. So again, same thing. If it's 0, we skip it. If it's 1, then the first lane will get written to the first position in memory. Skip this 0, and then this last one is a 1. So the last lane in the register will get written to the second position in memory. All right? All right, and then, so now we can build up from these and do more complicated things. But as I said, depending on where the memory is actually stored, you can only do 1-2 accesses per cycle. So it may not be done automatically in parallel. Now, for selective scatter and gather, this is slightly different than scatter gather you would see in a distributed database system. So that term means when you have a query and it has to touch data across multiple nodes, you break it up to smaller tasks, and you scatter the queries, those tasks, to the different nodes. They process in the data that they have locally, and then they bring it back to one single node and gather the results together. So in this case here, we're not doing queries, scatter, gather. We're moving data items back and forth between memory and our SIMD registers. So now what we're going to have here, we're going to have, again, the top piece of memory is our SIMD register, is our target, where we're going to write into. And then we're also going to have another SIMD register that's going to be the index vector. That's going to tell us, and for each lane that they correspond to, what location in memory do we want to write them into. So in this case here, for the first position at lane 0, it wants to write the data that exists at memory location 2. So 0, 1, 2 would be this one here, and we'd write that up into the first lane. For the second lane, it's position 1, so 0, 1, and it's a straight write up there, and so forth for 5 and 3. All right? And then the inverse of this is selective scatter. Where we still have the index vector that corresponds to our lanes in the value vector. And then the idea here is it's going to tell us at what position should we write the contents of this lane. So in this case here, the first one is the first lane as index vector 2. So it would go 0, 1, 2, and right there. This one is at lane 2. It's position 1. So 0, 1, that lane's written there, and so forth. All right? So this looks awesome, right? This looks like we can do complex things in parallel using these SIMD instructions. Well, it turns out it's not actually truly atomic and completely parallel. Because as I said, you can only have 1 or 2 accesses to read or writes or load and stores to L1 cache per cycle. So the other thing is that not all CPUs are going to support the vectorized scatter and gather. So in the case of the gather, it's only in the newer Haswells in AVX2. So if you get an older CPU like the Nehalem, they're not gonna have this vectorized instruction. And then the scatter is not in any current Xeon CPU. It's only in the Xeon Phi. Furthermore, the selective loads and stores are also not fully vectorized. In the case of the scatter, they're just doing it sequentially using assembly, right? So when you have the intrinsic, the compiler says, I don't have this vectorized instruction, here's the assembly to do the exact same step, but it runs them in serial order. In the case of selected loads and stores, it's not as bad as running it fully in serial order. They use some vectorized permutations to give you the answer you're looking for, but it's not going to be the single instruction that you had that I'm showing here, you would expect. Right? So selective load and store is going to be slightly a little slower than the truly vectorized version. But in the case of the scatter, it's not going to have a vectorized version at all, for the Xeons. The Xeon Phi will have all these things be vectorized. All right, so now, given we have selective store, selective load, and then the scatter and gather, we can now look at how to do the sort of more complicated things we expect to have in our database system, right? So we'll talk about how to do selection scans, hash tables, and partitioning. In the paper, they also talk about doing joins, sorting, and bloom filters. We sort of covered the sorting stuff before when we talked about the sort merge. With bloom filters, it's kind of obvious, right? You do a bunch of hashes on your input key, and you just do a bunch of vectorized lookups into your bloom filter to see whether the bit matches. For joins, I'll show the slides at the end. Actually, I should just say this in the beginning. The spoiler is, a lot of this stuff doesn't actually work. It's not just because in this paper they are looking at 32-bit keys and 32-bit tuple IDs. It's also because they assume everything's going to fit in your CPU caches. And we'll see this again when we look at the join numbers. Even if you had AVX 512, because you start exceeding CPU caches, you're always going to be bottlenecked on stalls to memory. And so vectorizing it doesn't actually help. I will show you, I'll talk about a technique on Tuesday next week for our own research here where we can actually rely on software prefetching to mask some of the latency of memory stalls and actually still do some of these vectorized operations. So again, it's sort of like the when we talked about the sort merge, I said yes, like it's an interesting approach, but you actually can't use it. I still think it's interesting to look at because whether or not you go and build a database system in the future, you may come across something where you say, oh, I know how to do this from the class, and I don't have to worry about 128-bit key value pairs, so I can use the SIMD. So it's worth discussing here, but it's again, the upfront, like this stuff doesn't actually always work, right? And they make a huge assumption about the cache sizes and the data set that always sits in caches and the size of the things you're trying to sort or do vectorized operations on are small enough. But you know, it is what it is. All right, so for the first example, I want to show you how to do SIMD selection scans. So I would say this will work in existing systems. And whenever you see vectorized execution, this is probably the most common. They'll do SIMD for selection scans. I think Impala does this. VectorWise gets it because they get automatic from the compiler. And I think HANA does this as well. All right, some of the in-memory systems can do this. All right, so for this, our sample query is a simple select star on this table where we have a predicate where the key is greater than equals some low value and less than equals some high value. So we're doing some range scan on a subset of the entire database. So what I want to first do is show you how to do this in a sort of a scalar manner. And like doing this sequentially. And I want to show the two different ways you can do this. One with branching, one without branching. And then you'll be able to recognize in the non-vector, you'll be able to see from the non-vectorized implementation without branching of how to then do this in a vectorized world. Because you can't do the branching one with vectorization, but you can do non-branching. So if you were like building a database system from scratch for the very first time, this is basically how you would implement a sequential scan. And this is currently how our own system actually works. Right? The basic idea is you have a for loop over some table, you're going to iterate and get every single tuple. You extract the key for that tuple, and then you do your predicate comparison, right, where key is greater than equal to low value and less than equal to high value. And if that predicate matches to true, then this if clause will branch down in here and then copy the tuple to your output buffer and increase the output buffer by one. So given what I said earlier about out-of-order execution, what's the problem with this approach? I realize you're reading source code on a slide, but again, we kind of have to do this, right? So what would happen here, right? Say if my query is, the predicate is 50% selectivity. That means for a billion tuples, half of them will evaluate to true and half of them will evaluate to false. What will happen in the actual CPU? What's that? Misprediction, exactly. So. The hardware wants to do out-of-order execution. It's going to see this if branch and say, oh, well, this is probably going to evaluate to true. So let me go ahead and do these instructions down here. Let me actually copy the data. But then if you get it wrong, it has to undo that and jump back over and flush the instruction pipeline to come back and do whatever it is it should be doing. So if you have the two extremes, if the selectivity is 0%, meaning no tuples match, or the selectivity is 100% where every tuple matches, then the branch predictor will be always correct, right? It's the ones where you have sort of like, in between there, then it's a coin toss whether it's going to predict this sort of right or not. So the key problem we have here is this if clause, because depending on the query, depending on the data, we may or may not be going down this branch, and therefore the CPU is going to have a hard time predicting this. Right? So this is the thing we want to avoid. We want to avoid this if clause. So we can actually rewrite this sequential scan without any if clause at all, doing it this way. So now in my for loop, I'm going to go still grab every single tuple, but the very first thing I'm going to do is actually copy the tuple to my output buffer. I haven't even looked to see whether the key matches. I'm saying, like, immediately just go in the output buffer. Then I extract the key, and then now what I have here, I have this sort of modification flag or modification integer, where I'll evaluate the predicate key greater than or equal to low and key less than or equal to high. And if either of these ones evaluate to true, then the modification flag will get set to 1. Right? And these are ternary operators that the CPU will execute with a few number of instructions. And then depending on whether the flag is 0 or 1, I will then increase my index or offset into my output buffer. So if it's 0, then I know when I loop back around, I do my next copy, I'm just going to overwrite the last tuple because the last tuple shouldn't be there. If it's 1, then when I come back around, I'll have moved over and I'll retain the tuple that I put in there the first time. Right? So this seems kind of crazy, right? This seems like a bad idea because we're always copying data, you know, for every single tuple, and then we check afterwards to see whether it actually should be there or not. Right? This seems, us as humans, as we write code, this seems counterintuitive. But because, again, we're an in-memory database, we're not having to go fetch things from disk, so therefore the penalty of having branch match prediction here is actually going to be greater than having to do this redundant copying. Right? And another way to think about this is that the CPU is always going to be executing the same set of instructions for every iteration in the loop, because it's no conditionals. So there is no branches to predict, so therefore it's always going to just blast through it very quickly. So to see how this affects performance, for this part here, there's this graph in one of the optional papers from VectorWise, where they vary along the x-axis the selectivity of a query. So 0% means that none of the tuples will match. 100% means every single tuple will match. And they're measuring the number of CPU cycles you're spending to process these tuples for these two different variations. So the red line going across horizontally, that's the no branching approach. And again, you see that the performance is always the same, as I said, because you're always executing the same instructions no matter what the query looks like or what the data looks like. But then this arc here is the branching case. And so what you see is that when you have very low selectivity, the branching case is better because you're not paying that penalty to copy things you don't need. But then as you increase the selectivity, it goes above and actually becomes worse because they're paying this penalty for branch match prediction. And then eventually at some point, the CPU gets better at predicting things. It's assumed that most of these things will actually get selected. And therefore it starts converging to the no branching case. Yes?
So couldn't you get a more direct comparison if you rewrote the branching case to just do the copy anyway, and then the branch would only be the increment?
So your question is, the statement is, I see what you're saying. Wouldn't a more direct comparison be take this copy, put it here, and then just have this if clause be just do this? The compiler might be smart enough to rewrite it to that. Right? Because it could look and say, all right, the only thing you're doing inside the zip branch is 1 plus, I plus 1. Yeah. So it could be smart enough to rewrite that. So what I'll say, though, is we'll see this again when we look at the Columbia results. They have one graph that doesn't actually follow this pattern here, which I don't fully understand. I've seen this the same result in other experiments or other systems, but for whatever reason, the Columbia guys don't exhibit this. So I don't, that part I don't understand of the results. All right, so now we can look and see how we can do the vectorized version of the branchless sequential scan. And so now what you see is that, again, when I iterate over my table, I'm using this v to represent the, with a subscript to represent a vectorized version of that variable. So I'm getting a vector of tuples, and then I can do a vectorized load of putting the key into my registers, to my CD register, and that's, again, writing it to the output buffer. Then I'll do my comparison, and what'll happen here is I'll generate a mask that we saw before to do the selective load and store. And then if all, if at least one of these values in the mask is set to one, then I know that I want to do I want to store that data into my output buffer. I take back, this loads the vector, this sets the mask mask up, and then I want it, if at least one of them is set to true, then I'll do my then I'll store my stuff into my output buffer and increase that. So you still have this if branch here. I think it can be rewritten without it, but it's not as bad as in the scalar approach because I can do this for across multiple for multiple tuples, right? So to walk it through it, say you have a simple query like this, where it selects star from table and the key is greater than O and less than equal to U, and this is our input sequence. We would start off by just taking this this all these values, immediately write it into our key vector. And this is another example where DSM makes a big difference, because if this is stored as a column store, I can just jump to this starting point and just write all that out to my single to my register in a single load operation, right? Where if it's NSM, then I may be jumping to different locations, and they may not all fit in a single cache line. So then I'll do my CMD compare, and that generates my mask. And then this is then will be used with a vector of offsets, you know, zero through five over here. And then I'll do my CMD store to take my mask and write those offsets into the output vector. So here I'm not actually copying the values that or the keys that I did my evaluation on. All I need is or actually even the IDs of the tuples. These correspond to offsets in the column here. Right, so one would be this position here, and three would be there, right? All right, so now we can look at the we can compare all these different approaches in our in the paper, and here I have two graphs. This one is going to be here for a Xeon Phi. It's going to have 61 cores plus four hyperthreads per core, and then this one is a Xeon. I think it's a Haswell. It has four cores. It's a single socket CPU with two hyperthreads per core. And again, along the x-axis, I'm going to vary the selectivity. And they're going to measure this in the throughput in terms of billions tuples per second. This seems like a lot. But remember, they're not actually implementing this in a real database system. They just have these little sort of toy system or toy implementations of just the algorithm. So you're not worrying about sort of moving things up an entire pipeline to your query plan. This is just to say, what does it take to actually do the sequential scan? So that's why they're getting really high numbers. So the first thing we see is that for the scalar branching case, in the case of the Xeon Phi, you don't really see a difference in performance as you change the selectivity because it's doing in-order execution. There's no branch miss predictions. The reason why it falls off is because you essentially run out of cache, or you're saturating the memory bandwidth or trying to write things to your output buffers. In the case of the the regular Xeon, this is where I'm saying I don't fully understand why they don't exhibit the property of branch miss prediction being this big penalty, because when you have 0% selectivity in this middle stuff here, you'd expect it to get worse and dip down, but it only goes down just a little bit. And I suspect, and so that I don't understand. I would expect it to get lower and then maybe arc back up. And then, of course, when it gets over here, you're just always saturated on the memory bandwidth, and that's why it sort of goes down in that trend. And then you can compare this with the branchless approach. And in here, what you see, this one makes sense to me because it's in-order execution. That means that it's always going to copy every single tuple, so you're not going to get any benefit over the branching one. So that's why this one's lower. And again, everyone saturates memory bandwidth over here. In this one here, again, I would expect it that these lines would have crossed in the middle. They're both hitting the memory bandwidth bottleneck over here, and that's why they converge. But I would expect these guys to flip in the middle as you increase the selectivity, but you don't really see that here. Actually, maybe you see that here at the 50%. So maybe that makes sense. So yeah, maybe this is the, actually, yes. This is the first part of the graph where I showed you where the selectivity was still very low. And then since it goes from 10 to 20 to 50, you don't really see the arc of the crossing that you see here. And of course, at 100% selectivity, they're all saturating memory bandwidth. But then you have the vectorized versions, and then we're going to have one for early materialization, where you do actually have to copy the tuple in your output buffer, and late materialization, where you only pass the offset. And again, the Xeon Phi makes sense, because the vectorization with late materialization, you just copy the offsets out, you don't have to do anything else, where if you actually go back and actually copy the data in your output buffer, then that slows you down. I don't fully understand why these guys match up over here. Because I would expect late materialization to match with early materialization. So maybe my number's just wrong, right? But that I don't think that should be right. All right, so now we can look at how to do vectorized hash table probing. So again, first I'll start off with the scalar version, and then we'll see how to make this make this run in parallel with SIMD. So in the scalar version, essentially what you do is you take your input key for you know, in your for loop, iterating every single tuple, you're going to hash it, and it's going to produce some offset in your hash table. And for this, I'm using that open addressing linear probing hash table that we talked about before, where instead of having these linked lists of buckets, you're just going to point to a single location, and if you find a match, you're done. If you don't find a match, then you just do linear scan down the table to find the key that you're looking for. So in this first lookup, key 1 doesn't equal key 9, so we know that we need to keep on scanning down and keep doing additional comparisons to either we find an empty slot, which means that our key isn't in here, or we find a match for our key. Right? So again, this is the scalar version. What are we doing? We're dealing with a single tuple at a time, or a single key at a time, and then we're doing a single comparison at a time as we scan through the table. So the way to do this with vectorized or horizontal vectorization is that now what's going to happen in our hash table, for every single position, every single slot, we're going to store multiple keys, and they have corresponding multiple payloads. So in this case here, we're going to have 4 keys per slot, and then therefore we have to have 4 payloads. So we're still going to now evaluate, though, a single key at a time. We'll hash it just like before, and then it's going to point to some position. But now what we're going to do is at that position, we're going to get back a vector now, and then we can use our SIMD compare operator to evaluate our input key with every single key in the vector. And then this will produce a mask, and then based on that, it'll determine whether we need to keep on scanning down to find the thing we're looking for, or we find one that we know we need. And the idea is that the way that you would insert into this is that when you hash for the insert and you land at some space, you would, if all the positions are full, you go to the next one, but if one position is available, then you write into there. So as soon as your comparison finds one empty position, you know you've completed your scan. So this seems nice. This allows us to parallelize the comparison to take a single key and look at multiple values. But the problem is that we are still processing one key at a time for our input sequence. So with vertical vectorization, the idea is that we'll take a batch of tuples and do the comparison in parallel across our table. So again, we'll hash them all at once. We'll then produce our hash vector, and then that's going to point to these different locations. So then we can use our SIMD gather to write them out at the values at these positions into our SIMD vector, and then we can do our SIMD comparison, and then this will produce either a 0 or 1 based on whether we have a match. So if they're all 1s, then that's easy for us, because then we just go back to our input sequence and jump down to the next 4 vectors. But it's very likely that they're not all going to be 1s. And so in this case here, you see the first guy and the last guy are 1, but these middle guys are 0 here. So if I was being sort of a naive way to deal with this is that I'll just, for these 2 keys here, I'll just iterate down or increment in my hash table the address and just fill in new values for these keys here and just keep whatever the first guy and the last guy had and just do the same comparison again, right? Because I don't want to increment them, because then they would actually produce correct results. So if I know that these guys already matched, then I avoid having to look at other matches. But in that case, we're getting bad lane utilization, because these guys are essentially doing wasted work. We already know they match. We don't need to keep comparing them. So and then furthermore, if like say the second guy matches, and now it's only this one we need to keep doing comparisons for, now we're essentially just doing this in sequential order. okay? Because, and it's even worse because we're loading things in and out of our SIMD registers. That doesn't come for free. So the way they're going to handle this in to do vertical vectorization is that they'll recognize that the first one and the last one match, and therefore when they go back into the input sequence, they'll just load in the next two values you need in your keys or in your input sequence and just replace replace them in these slots. You then have to hash them and find new locations. But then you know that you don't need to rehash these keys. You just want to increment their address by one. So then now you can go back in the hash table, do the same probe again, and now all your lanes will be looking at new data, right? And so this is not, this is not easy to do because there's some extra bookkeeping you need to have to say like, all right, well this position is already matched. This other position hasn't. But again, you're going to get better lane utilization. They also talk in the paper about how if you do this approach, you end up making your algorithm unstable. And that means that if I take the same query on the same database and I run it through this vectorized algorithm, on one day it may produce results in one order. The next day it may produce results in another order. That's not necessarily a bad thing. And actually, we don't even care in a database system because we're dealing with bag algebra, right, with relations. We don't care about the order of tuples in our output. If you cared about the order and you wanted to make sure the result was always stable, then you should put us order by. Tell us to do an order by and we'll do it. So I don't think this makes a big difference in, it does make a difference in correctness. It may make it harder to debug because every single time you run this vectorized probe in your join, it may do things in different orders. But that's why they pay us a lot of money to work on these things, right? We'll deal with that. All right, so running out of time, but I'll go through this quickly. So for this one, they're gonna compare the performance difference between the scalar approach, the vectorized horizontal probing, and then the horizontal and vertical. And along the x-axis, they're gonna increase the size of the hash table, and this will make a big difference. You'll see in a second. So, in the scalar version, what you see is that the Xeon 5 really doesn't get there's not really a big performance drop as you decrease the you're going to see the same drop on both of these architectures because at this point here at 1 megabytes, now the hash table is larger than your cache size, right? Because the Xeon 5 cores don't have a L3, so you're exceeding your L2 cache. And then it sort of flatlines. In the case of the Xeon, the going beyond 4 megabytes is when you exceed your CPU caches, and that's why it falls off here. Right? And then in the case of the vectorized stuff, you don't see a major difference in the horizontal vectorization for the Xeon Phi. I actually don't know the reason why that's the case. I can think about it for a bit, but you definitely see a huge performance improvement in the vertical one. And then in the case of the Xeon, they flip going from 64 kilobytes to 256 kilobytes, where the horizontal one actually performs better than the vertical one. But again, they all essentially become the same once you exceed your CPU caches. So this is what I said before, like all these algorithms seem really sophisticated, really cool, but once you go beyond your CPU caches, it doesn't actually matter. So beyond the CPU caches, right, they're all the same. Okay. So to show you how to do a build a histogram real quickly. The way we do this is when you scatter and gather, do increment things, and then we'll be able to replicate the histogram to handle collisions. So let's say this is our input key vector, and we want to use a SIMD radix extraction that we talked about before with the hash joins to generate a hash vector. And then for each of these slots, they would point to a position. So each of these caches will point to a position in our histogram, and all we just do is we just increment the count by one, right? But this actually doesn't work because the second key and the last key actually point to the same location. So if you then try to do a vectorized add on this, whatever value got in there last will end up being there. You can't do this atomically, with a compare and swap. So putting one in here will overwrite override the other lane putting it in there. So the way you can handle this is actually to replicate or have multiple histograms, one per lane, and at each lane in our hash index vector corresponds to one lane in the histogram. So then this guy only writes to this lane, the second guy only writes to this lane, so they're always going to be in new locations. And then you just do a SIMD add to combine them together to produce the correct result. So you have to do an extra add and have to have more registers to do this, but then you'll produce the correct result. So this doesn't work if you have composite keys. This only works if you have single scalar keys you want to build your histogram on. Right? If you want to build a histogram on five attributes, this doesn't work. But for single scalars, it does work. All right, so real quickly, I'm not going to go through how to do joins. In their comparison, they're looking at so the no partitioning case, and then min partitioning and max partitioning. So this would be the min partitioning would be the where you partition the build side of the join. You build one hash table per thread, and then the max partitioning is sort of like the grace hash join, where you're partitioning both the probe side and the join side, or the probe side and the build side of the join operator. Right, and both of these be fully vectorized, and this one will only be partially vectorized. And the main takeaway from this is that with full vectorization and partitioning both sides, then you get the best performance over all these other ones. If you try to do the grace hash join with just doing scalar operations, then you're actually going to end up performing worse than everyone else, right? And again, this is not surprising because you're doing more work to end up with the same result at these other ones here. So and again, if you look at again with the size of the keys and payloads, it's 32 bit integers and keys for keys and payloads. So like this is not real. You couldn't actually do this. So I'm only showing also the Xeon Phi numbers here. I forget what happens in the regular one. I think the vectorized one may not make a big difference. All right, so I sort of rushed through the end, but as I was going along, I think this is the way that paper describes how to do vectorization. I think is really interesting, and I think it's definitely useful for other aspects outside of database systems. So I think it'll be relevant to your careers, once you leave CMU or go on to other things. But the main takeaway I want you to remember is beyond just the size of the keys and payloads. This doesn't actually work unless you use if everything doesn't fit in your CPU caches, and as you can imagine, in a real-world system, this is going to be very unlikely. So none of these algorithms would actually work directly as they're written. You have to do some extra stuff, which I'll talk about on Tuesday, to make this actually work with a with databases or data sets that exceed your size of your CPU caches. The other aspect that's very important too is that all the other optimizations we talked about, how to do all the other parallelization techniques we've been talking about for our algorithms. They're all still applicable. We can combine them together with the vectorization stuff that we talked about here. So now again, it's multiplicative. So if we have, if our algorithm can run on 32 cores, and we have 4x speed up with vectorization, we'll be able to get 120x speed up of our algorithms. That's not always going to be, and that's the theoretical upper bounds, but obviously it's not always going to be the case because there's going from one operator to the next, there's a lot of marshaling of data back and forth, and not everything's going to be able to be vectorized. Right. Sometimes you have to do sequential operations to put the data into the correct order you need, right? And also too, there's no reason a compile plan using all the stuff we talked about last class couldn't also use vectorized operations. To the best of my knowledge, though, our system is the only one that actually does this. So Hyper does compile plans, and Hyper does but the combination of interpreted plans and compile plans. And they don't do any vectorization in the compiled parts. VectorWise doesn't do explicit vectorization, right? They rely on the compiler to do that for them. But everyone else, as far as I know, because of this CPU cache size limitation, nobody actually does all of these things. All right, so on Tuesday next week, I will spend the first half talking about another vectorization technique. And then I'll talk about the technique that we've developed here that combines compilation and vectorization for data sets that exceed your CPU caches. And the sort of secret sauce that's going to make this work is through software prefetching, which we haven't really talked about in this course, and it's actually not really used, as far as I know, in any other in-memory database system, but we are finding actually that this is the way to make this all work. In terms of Project 3, there's a bunch of stuff coming out in the next couple weeks that you need to be aware of. So one, we'll have the first code submission for doing reviews on April 11th, and I'll put instructions on how you match up with your team and what you're expected to do. Then on the 13th, there won't be a class, and what I'll do is we'll arrange 10-minute meetings for every group to come meet me in my office, maybe 15 minutes might be better. We'll come and meet just individually, and we'll talk about what the status of your project, what are the problems you're having, and you know, what's the current, you know, where do you think you can go? And then when we come back on the following Tuesday, then we'll have the in-class updates where you come present just like before when you did for proposals and tell everyone what the status of your system is, what are some of the things that you fixed, what are some problems that you're having, so that, again, everyone knows what's going on. And I think the first review will have to be due on the 18th as well. It's due the 7 days after you submit your code to each other. Okay? Any questions? So again, I will send the email out today. There's some more bug fixes we had to take care of about how to rebase and get the latest version. I know some of you also require or need the new catalog. You should talk to those guys in the back about how to get their code and so you can start playing with it. We're pretty close to merging it in, but it may not be ready for everyone else. But if you do actually need it, you can get started on it now. Okay? All right, guys, have a good weekend, although it's going to snow tomorrow. And I'll see you on Tuesday.